Welcome to the future. PBS Digital.
When I was a little girl, growing up on the Indian reservation, Navajo reservation, I used to think that we were the only Indians in the world. I thought, you know, because I really never really gone out of the reservation. I always stayed home, and I used to go up there, and I used to sing songs to myself. I used to do, can you believe it, Barbra Streisand songs way up there. And I used to watch movies like Fiddler on the Roof. I used to sing some of those songs, like I'm Far, Far Away from Home. There's a song in there. And I said, you know, someday I'm going to leave this reservation. I'm going to leave this nest and go out there and fly away. There's got to be something out there. I see cars going by, and where are they going, you know? And I always wanted to just jump on one of those and just, where will it take me?
The journey of Terra Boggis is the epic adventure of Native America, our own version of the Odyssey. It's the story of thousands of American Indian families who made their way from poor reservations to the cities in the last half of the 20th century.
Okay, what does that mean?
It is also my story. My name is Mark Anthony Rollo. My mother, Corrine, was a full-blood Ojibwe from the Bad River Band in northern Wisconsin. She caught a bus to Milwaukee at the end of World War II, looking for a job, and met my father. Donald Rollo was the son of French and Irish farmers. His own life was a struggle, and he turned to alcohol. My quiet mother was always tired, but rarely complained. With nine brothers and a sister, I grew up a half-breed on the south side of Milwaukee in the 1960s, playing football in the shadow of Polish generals, outsiders in our own land. We were the first generation of true urban Indians. In our working-class neighborhood, we were the poorest family on the block. The Bad River Reservation was not a part of our lives. I never learned to speak my mother's language or participate in Ojibwe ceremonies. I retreated into the dream world of television and found a new paradise. I imagined living in Los Angeles, a place where my family could escape from the poverty and sorrow of our daily lives. Maybe one day.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. The John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation. The Ford Foundation. And by contributions to your public television station by viewers like you. Thank you.
Years after my childhood dreams faded, I finally made my way to Los Angeles. I came as a journalist in search of the largest Native American community in the nation, over 200,000, according to the Census Bureau. I thought I knew what I would find, but it turned into a deeper adventure than I could ever imagine. Los Angeles isn't like Milwaukee or Rapid City or Phoenix, which have strong ties to nearby reservations. There's no center to the Indian community in Los Angeles. Even the old Indian bars on Skid Row have been gone since the 1970s. Most Native people prefer the shadows. It's easier to shrug your shoulders when someone speaks to you in Spanish. Buenos dias. No more questions. There are glitzy casinos in the suburbs owned by small bands of California Indians. And I can find the shadows of ancient Tongva names along the freeways. But 90% of the Indians in Los Angeles are immigrants from the center of the nation. They are invisible. Where are they?
Hey, okay.
For the last 100 years, the gateway to Indian life in Southern California has been the sprawling campus of Sherman Indian School in Riverside, one of the last of the boarding schools created by the Bureau of Indian Affairs at the end of the 19th century.
Pull it up tight, and now this one, come bring it around, and it goes over. So it's just the opposite, and you try to keep it snug.
Make sure you guys back up each other.
Sometimes when you're learning Navajo, you gotta get some spit going in your mouth.
Five generations of Indians from tribal reservations as far away as New Mexico, Montana, and North Dakota have passed through Sherman on their journey into white culture. Boys cut their braids and joined the ROTC. Girls learned to sew and cook. Students were forbidden to speak their tribal languages. Their religions were banned, and they were forced to pray to a Christian god. Children came to Sherman as Navajo, or Lakota, or Creek, but they graduated as Americans. Many resisted, some dropped out and returned to their reservations, but many stayed against the odds and passed through the gateway to new lives in the city.
I remember one Andy Kalzer's, when I told him, I said, I want to go to college. And he said to me, you'll never make it. I said, why? Because you're not smart enough. I said, yes, I am. I'm smart enough. I can do it, you know. I said, why don't you go to vocational school? Be a nurse. Be something else. You know, just go to a two-year training, and then you'll be back on the res. I said, I don't want to do that. So I decided to go to Cal State Fullerton, and that's where I ended up. 10 students from Sherman went, and by the end of the first year, I was the only one left. And it was scary. There was something in me that just kept going. I said, I can do it. I can prove that. I kept looking at that. I kept thinking about that counselor, what he said to me. You'll never make it.
Of course, Tara Bogus did make it.
So when we sing this, remember, don't look all sad. You're happy that you're going home.
For over a decade, she has taught Navajo language and Native American history at Sherman. But like many members of her generation, she paid a heavy price for her decision to leave the tribe for the city. She is haunted by the decision not to teach her own children how to speak Navajo or participate in Navajo ceremony.
That is my fault. I think there's something going on back in the back of my head. When I was a student here, when I was 14 years old, we were told not to speak Navajo. In fact, I got a demerit, you know, punished for that. So somewhere in my head, it's saying to me, don't teach your son the language.
These days, Sherman itself has changed. This old relic from an age of repression and assimilation now struggles to find itself as a college prep high school where Indian students from 100 tribes attend, not to lose their native identity, but to reclaim it.
This is the time to fulfill the dreams of our ancestors who shed blood and tears in the name of our nation, our land, and our pride of our people. Native Americans for centuries have been oppressed and converted to aliens to our own culture. It is time to rise and get our education, to stay in the right path, to fight this war with our minds, and to build our own roads to success.
A long time ago, my great-grandmother came here, and Sherman does give Native Americans much more opportunities. At home, I wasn't really doing that great, like getting in trouble and stuff. But here, I'm doing really good. I graduated on my right year, and I got a $2,000 scholarship, and I'm so happy.
On three!
For all the criticism of the boarding schools, I'm drawn to the simple grace of Indians among Indians. That's a reality I never had growing up. I never sat at the drum. I never learned the songs of the Ojibwe. Why didn't my mother pass them to me? Here at Sherman, I'm surprised by the envy I feel for the young men gathered at the drum.
As he was saying,
It's August. I have been in Los Angeles for 3 months. From nowhere and everywhere, thousands of Indians descend on the Orange County Fairgrounds. This is the largest gathering of Indians in Southern California each year. Perhaps the only time when even 2,000 of the 200,000 people claiming Native heritage will get together. Who are they? Where did they come from? The presence of Sherman High School is everywhere. There's Henry Hale at the drum. He's Navajo. And his wife Lucy, matriarch of the powwow's most popular Indian taco stand. Both are Sherman graduates.
How many should I put in there?
But there are other roots here as well.
Well, these guys work real hard. You gotta be young to do this dance.
Randy Edmonds is an authentic urban pioneer, one of Southern California's most popular powwow announcers. He's Cato and Kiowa from Anadarko, Oklahoma.
And I was kind of hanging around the corners and, you know, drinking with the boys. And my aunt, my Kiowa aunt, she said she wasn't too pleased with that. And her husband was the BIA relocation project officer. So he put out an APB on me. And when I got there, he scolded me, of course, and said, you know, you're better than this. You shouldn't be hanging around with all those winos, you know, and you need to go somewhere and change your lifestyle. He says, now I have these 7 cities that you have a choice to go to.
On 2 days' notice, he scrambled aboard a train in Clinton, Oklahoma, with his wife and infant daughter, and rolled west to Los Angeles. It was 1954.
Tell me about the train ride.
The train ride, when we left Oklahoma, I had $10 in my pocket, and we had a basket of chicken that was cooked up for us by the family, and so...
It wasn't a live chicken, was it? Cooked chicken.
Yeah, it was kind of like KFC is today, you know, some of that lard that they put in that chicken during those days. It was very good. We didn't even get out of Oklahoma where we had that ate up, you know.
At the height of the relocation program, 200 people a week rolled into Union Station.
And I caught a cab, and I told the cab driver, I says, show me the tallest building in town. And just about that time, we were going by City Hall. He said, that's it right there. So that was the tallest building in Los Angeles when I arrived 48 years ago.
They want all the boys and the men first.
Paula Starr is a child of relocation, great-granddaughter of the Southern Cheyenne Peace Chief Black Kettle, who barely escaped the Sand Creek Massacre in 1864. In the 1960s, Paula moved to Los Angeles with her parents.
How did your parents leave Oklahoma?
Jobs.
Jobs.
I think anybody and everybody that had a glimmer of adventure, hope, came because it was a new way of life. And this was a Mecca area. I mean, it's just, it was a happening. The whole idea of relocation was to mainstream into the dominant society. And it did. And it geographically put us all over the place. It was designed to get them out and get them away from their tribal homelands and hopefully destroy that tribal link.
Their intent was to assimilate us into the mainstream of society. And that how they did that was to separate us, keep us away from each other. Although there were a lot of Indians coming in, we weren't put into any particular community. And that still is true today. You can't find in Los Angeles or San Diego or San Francisco
one central community
like the Asians and the African Americans, where they have homes and stores and, you know, that kind of environment.
Many immigrants fell hard against the city. Too many drank themselves to death in the Skid Row bars known as Indian Alley. If they were lucky, they found their way to the Knife Chief family.
So Indians would come.
This one family, the Knife Chiefs, they opened up their garage in the city of Stanton and started distributing food. I mean, that's how basic it was. Naturally evolved to where, hey, let's go to this park and powwow.
And so they began to find each other. After a basketball game at Sherman, a picnic at Ford Park, at the Silver Saddle Saloon in Pico Rivera. Indians from different tribes and different traditions began to gather at the drum.
We had discovered a place called Hill X, and it's right up here where Dodger Stadium is, and that's where we used to come, and we drive up there in all our cars, and we get out and use the hood of a car, or if somebody brought a paper box, or if there was a plastic trash can around, we'd use that for a drum, and we'd sing our 49 songs.
Yeah, folks would come in after the powwow. Sometimes they'd come to our house and party. The 49ing, you know, the drumming and singing. Some neighbors didn't like it, but they got used to it. And I still remember to this day, my mom had a green linoleum flooring in the kitchen. And the Indian women, I don't mean to say anything bad, but they were high heels. And I remember the indentations in the flooring from them walking on the floor.
In 1956, we had the first powwow. And that basically began the powwow creation in this area. And to see what it is today, I mean, it's a whole tremendous difference.
But it was a different powwow, though.
Well, it was a smaller version of this. But there was no vendors, nobody got paid. We just sang and danced. You know, nobody really had any regalias of any kind. Now it's huge across America. We weren't allowed to do that back in the 40s, early 50s. The government says, you know, you guys, you know, too warlike.
A few anthropologists have promoted the idea that powwow culture could be the embryo of a new urban Indian tribe, English speaking, with its own ceremonies, dances, and social relations. But I wonder how many reservation Indians with their own deep tribal roots would dismiss the idea as an example of how far urban Indian culture has been assimilated and drifted apart from the tribes.
For our young people to become administrators, camera people.
You made all this stuff? Pardon? You made this stuff?
Yes.
What tribe is this?
I'm Chippewa from North Dakota.
Chippewa?
Yeah.
I'm Chippewa too.
Where are you from?
Wisconsin, Bad River. Turtle Mountain.
Turtle Mountain.
What's your name?
Jake Runsbuffalo.
Mark Anthony Rollo. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, yeah.
Fellow Ojibwe, meet up in Los Angeles.
Yeah, LA, huh?
LA. It's like... But this is not Chippewa art.
No, I don't. I used to do a lot of, all I did when I came to California was beadwork, and then I got here and nobody knew what it took to do beadwork, so I switched to silver.
Switched to silver.
Many tribes have lost their own traditions. They've lost their own dances and pretty much lost their language. So in order to retain your Indianness, you have to borrow from another tribe to keep that Indianness going. The younger generation has picked up on that, and you see Navajos dancing the northern tribal ways. You see the southern Indians dancing northern tribal ways, the northern tribes dancing the southern tribal ways. Southwestern Indians, California Indians, all involved in the powwow.
Well, you know, in the olden days, when Indians came to this town, there was more of a tribal sense of identity.
Oh, yeah, you could clearly see what tribe people came from. You could tell by their moccasins and their regalia, their outfits. Oh, that's a Comanche. You know, look at their moccasins. And you wouldn't even have to, you know, get that close. You could just tell. Nowadays, it's kind of hard to distinguish what tribe a person is because of all the rhinestones and neon colored stuff. You know, I'm like, okay, what are they? We have, you know, Apaches dancing. We have Senecas dancing.
Tribes that never had powwow.
Exactly. And the Casino tribes here in California, you know, they had their own, you know, bird songs and other things, but we've adapted intertribally, and we've adapted the Plains culture because it's spectacular. It's eye-moving. It's eye-catching.
Is that okay for us to do that?
I think it's okay because that drum, it's calling your spirit. That's what it's doing. So yeah, it's okay.
I've been to a lot of powwows, but I've never felt comfortable in the arena. I'm not a dancer, and I'm out of step with the values of competition and prize money. The booths that sell water buffalo horns from Asia and all the effort to make tribal culture accessible to the white community. But in our attempt to reach out, have we traded the depth and uniqueness of tribal identity for pan-Indian stereotype? Have powwows reduced all Indian identity to a snapshot of Plains Indian culture from the 19th century? I don't fit in at the big urban powwows, but I think I might have found a seat at the drum among the small, lonely band of relocation pioneers on Hill X. Indians have deep spiritual traditions, so it should come as no surprise that even as Christian missionaries were participating in the cultural genocide of the tribes, individual Indian families were drawn to the faith, and Christianity has been a very effective tool of assimilation in the cities.
We let kids from Sherman in this church. All right, where are they at? All right, let's have them all stand up and everybody look at them. All the kids from Sherman, stand up.
In the days of relocation, Bell Gardens was called the Rez. It was one of the few communities scattered across Southern California where Indians and Indian bars were concentrated. When the government failed to help Indians adjust to city life, evangelical churches like the Indian Revival Center reached out.
There's a guy whose name is Arthur Stone King who came here in the 1950s, and he basically by calling was a missionary evangelist. Indian bars were kind of littered in the community, and he would go there and go into the bars. There was a little frame building that he started having church in here, and in the 1960s, which was the kind of the height of the growth of this church, they would have over 300, maybe 400 people at times.
But I've got good news for you today, and that is Jesus has gained an interest in you. And he loves you with a love that never fails. Can you say praise the Lord for that? Amen. How many of you are glad today Jesus loves Indians? Amen.
Growing up, I had a stronger connection to Jesus than I did to my Ojibwe culture. I grew up Catholic. After my mother passed on, I became a born-again Christian. Just before I turned 30, I was returning home from a visit to New York City. I sat next to an old German woman on a Greyhound bus. It was her first trip to the U.S., and she told me she had come here to meet real Indians. I was her first one. When she asked if she could touch my face, I remember feeling that she had somehow exposed me. I looked Indian, but I didn't feel it. From that moment on, I knew I was not going to return to the church. I realized I was starting a new journey in search of my Ojibwe identity. Ironically, that search has brought me right back into the church.
You came from heaven to earth to show my way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Like thousands of relocation pioneers, Judy Tutu found her way to the Indian Revival Center.
I came in February 1957.
From where?
From Oklahoma. We came on the relocation plan. My mom and dad and 10 children, and we came on the train. I couldn't believe how warm it was, and we just walked down the street, and I just loved it here.
Judy met her husband, Marvin, at a basketball game at Sherman High School, but she could never find a balance with his alcoholism. In despair, she turned to the church and was born again.
The missionary's wife, she started playing the piano, real beautiful, and they started singing in tongues, and it sounded like angels singing, and I just loved it.
My wife, she'd come to church, and I would go to the bar. It was like that a long time.
She came to It's Saturday morning, and I've been invited to the men's prayer breakfast. One after another, these men share the stories that brought them to Jesus.
And I knew it was in my mind, but I heard like a real pleasant voice says, go to church. And I'm thinking, man, I need a beer. I'm having DTs. And then I'm thinking about it, and I could hear another, I don't know if it was in my brain, but I had another voice saying, everybody hates you in that church. And I'm thinking, man, I'm going crazy, I know him. But I come on in, I come around there, my wife's sitting there, and there's an empty seat there, and I look up, and I know everybody in church. Ken introduced me, and Ken says, you know what? He said, I'm going to tell you something. He says, see all these people? For 20 years, we've been praying for you. And the Lord answered your prayer.
Marvin Tutu hasn't had a drink since that day.
We're going to sing Hallelujah, so help me on this one, all right? Hallelujah, Yahagakles. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Yahagakles. Hallelujah. Itkinagalgi.
There are 15 tribes around this table. Pastor Preston is there, and Ken Taylor. Ken is Creek. He's a former basketball coach and principal at Sherman. He's active in Creek Nation politics. He has been a leader of the church for over 30 years, and he is the glue that holds this group together.
Amen. At this time, we want to go and have a time of laughter. So we're going to go into that portion of our program or our activity here where we have holy humor. Okay, so we ask the men to bring a joke or something about their life they can share with us that we can laugh with them. Okay, normally I will start it off and then you guys just jump in. Okay, two Creek guys are driving a pickup along, I think it's 16 near 10 Killer Lake, Tahlequah?
Yeah.
And they saw these three Cherokee guys hitchhiking. And they're talking to each other. They said, should we give these Cherokee guys a ride? And they said, yeah, let's give them a ride. And, you know, they're Cherokees. So they stopped and they asked the Cherokee guys, hey, you guys want a ride? And he said, yeah, we want a ride. That's why we're out here thumbing. He said, well, jump in the back. So they jumped in the back of the pickup and the Creek guys took off driving along the Ten Killer Lake and they went around the corner too fast and the pickup turned over and landed in the lake. Well, the Creek guys got out, went to the top and swam to the shore. And they looked around and they didn't see the three Cherokee guys. They waited and waited and pretty soon they were getting worried, so they thought, we better go back in and try to find them. About that time, three heads popped to the top and swam to shore. And the Creek guy says, hey, what happened to you guys? We were waiting. We thought something happened to you guys. And the Cherokee guy says, we couldn't get the tailgate down.
The members of the prayer group make great light of the tribal origin of their jokes.
That's a Cherokee joke.
This Creek, he goes to Mexico.
But these jokes aren't really tribal at all. That's part of what's been lost in the city. These could just as easily be Polish jokes or Irish jokes. I wonder how much the drift away from tribal identity has to do with living in the city. And how much has to do with being Christian.
Even though I'm proud of my heritage, I'm a Choctaw Indian, but God is the owner of my life now because he sent his son to die on the cross for my life. So all things are to him first. I'm a child of God, then I'm a Choctaw Indian, then I'm an American, eh?
I'm not a person who is enamored by Indian culture. Most things about Indian culture I do not like, don't care for. I like Indians. I love Indians. I like to be around Indians. I just don't like some of the cultural things that attend that. I don't have any predisposition toward lifting up ancient Indian culture in its ideas of power and its ideas of spiritism, for instance. I see that as, I personally
see that as destructive. And our message here at the church, and my message that always is that Jesus said he was the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by him. And if I can get Indians to accept that and believe that, then come and go with us.
Love the Indian, but hate the culture. You know, it's not so different from the promise a century ago that the boarding schools would kill the Indian and save the man.
There will always be the distinction between traditionalist and Christianity. You will always have that. And in the LA area, you'll find probably more traditionalist than those that believe in Christ. You can go to Ford Park, which is right over here, when they have the powwows, and you'll see that that parking lot is full, and the streets are over, there's no place to park. But like Pastor said, the Indian churches are like half full, if that, on any Sunday morning.
Part of the problem for the churches is the romantic interest of young people in the revival of traditional tribal culture. But the bigger problem is the retirement of elderly relocation pioneers back to their reservations. Even though they have embraced Christianity, these elders are the last native speakers, the last reservoirs of tradition, dance, and ceremony. When they move back home and pass on, the second and third generations will be completely cut off in the cities. It's a warm Sunday afternoon at Ford Park, just a few miles from the church.
All right, here we go. We want to get started.
Ken Taylor is presiding over the second quarterly picnic of the Muscogee Creek community in Southern California. 50, 60 people, lots of food, lots of kids, and lots of questions about just what it means to be a member of an Indian nation whose ancient homeland is in Alabama and whose modern capital is in Oklahoma.
You gotta remember that there's Creeks that were born out here that probably never have been back to Oklahoma. There's also people that are out here that have heard they were Creeks for years and they had no way to prove it.
So how much are you? Blood?
I am,
what did she say a while ago?
135th?
Yeah.
Yeah, 135th.
You're pretty blooded out.
Yeah.
Just about. They told him not to cut himself.
How much degree of Indian blood do you need to have?
The Creek Nation does not have a set blood quantum. It's by descendancy.
Oh, okay.
Have you ever had a CDIB card?
I guess I do. I recently got two cards in the mail.
Okay.
So I think I
That's
do.
One of them is a CDIB. The CDIB is a Certificate Degree of Indian Blood card. And if you were another of the five tribes, which is the Seminole, the Creeks, Cherokees, Choctaws, and Chickasaws, that CDIB would combine your total blood quantum. For instance, you know, I'm Creek, Seminole, and Chickasaw, and my card shows that I'm 4/4.
Okay.
But my tribal card shows that I'm only 1/8 Creek because I'm a citizen of the Creek Nation.
This whole blood thing is as confusing as it sounds. In ancient days, there just wasn't a tradition of defining tribal identity by blood. It was language and land, ceremony and family that gave a person tribal identity. But around the beginning of the 20th century, the federal government forced tribes to start using blood quantum and old, often inaccurate census counts to define tribal membership. Over the decades, blood quantum replaced tribal culture as a way of identifying who was an Indian. Many tribes began to issue membership cards with federal ID numbers that the government gives to real Indians. It's a curious form of branding. My number is 430-002249. Mark Anthony Rollo, a member of the Ojibwe Nation since 1962.
My father was a white man and my mother was full-blood Creek, so I'm a half-breed.
50 years ago, the worst thing you could call an Indian was a half-breed. But today, a person with Chief Ellis's blood quantum among the Creek is almost like royalty.
Out of a tribal enrollment of 55,000, we've got 42,000 at what we call thin bloods. They're less than a quarter. So we have lots of people that are, probably don't consider themselves Indians. In order to hold an office, you have to be one quarter. And our people in our tribe that are wanting to do away with that blood quantum that would let anybody that's a member be elected official. I was looking at the books last week, and we've got seven people in our tribe that are 1/1,000. So I'm very scared of it because I wouldn't want a person 1/1,000 being elected chief.
A.D. Ellis is here because he wants to include urban citizens in tribal affairs. But he's also here because he's running for the job of principal chief, and he knows from past elections that the citizens at this picnic could swing the election.
Well, we only had 1,200 people vote in our nation out of 14,000. Now that 1,250 voters, 955 were absentees. We even have people that run for office back in Oklahoma that lose in our boundaries, yet the absentee voters in California give them enough votes where they win the race.
The Creek Nation is supported these days by six casinos, and with citizenship comes the opportunity for a decent job, meal programs for senior citizens, cheap car license tags, better housing, burial expenses, and of great importance to the people gathered at Ford Park, college scholarships for young people.
Well, why is it so important for you all to be enrolled? How does that matter?
Yeah, they need to go to school. I mean, all these kids, we don't have funds. You know, we're all minimum wage, maybe a little more.
We're enrolled members, and they use our membership as part of their budget to get monies to run the tribe. And yet we're not in the state of Oklahoma or in the jurisdiction of the Creek Nation. And so those people that are in the jurisdiction, they have the benefits of Indian Health Service, housing, a number of things. And we, outside of that district, we don't have that benefit.
Chief Ellis sees a very different tribe in 50 years. His vision is more about economic development than cultural preservation. The tribe will be English-speaking, spread out across the nation, and the economy of the tribe will follow its members. But Second Chief Alfred Berryhill worries that two classes of citizenship are now emerging.
People somehow or another find out their ancestry is of Creek descent, and all they want is the tags. They want the free medicine from our health care, and they're wanting housing. And those kind of people who are real, we call thin blood, are more aggressive than our more full bloods, half and more. And they get all the services.
Alfred Berryhill is part of another movement within the Creek Nation. But you have to go back in the woods outside Okmulgee, Oklahoma, to find it. It's a special Sunday at the Berryhill Methodist Church.
Good morning. This is a good day, isn't it? It's good to be here this morning, isn't it? We just welcome you all this morning in the name of the Lord. Also this morning, we have come to honor one of us who, in our community, Martha Berryhill, who's celebrating her 104th birthday. And God,
Martha Berryhill is one of only three remaining Creeks who hold their original land allotments from the early 1900s. Her nephew, Alfred, is second chief. He is a devout Christian, deacon of the local church, and leader of the movement to restore traditional Creek culture, singing Christian hymns in Creek and participating in the ancient green corn ceremony is the essence of what Creek culture is today.
To come to the Creek churches and hear Creek singing is unique. And in that the songs that we sing originated from the ceremonial ground to the church. So there was an evolution of spirituality, you might say. When I was being raised here, there were nine houses. Each one of them had families living in it, and they all spoke fluent Creek. And our churches was fluent songs, fluent prayers, fluent ministry, and that's all I was. That's all I knew was Creek. And until I got into school, then I started learning English.
We're going to send smoke signals.
Yes, they're chopping that meat up now.
Yeah.
We're sending smoke signals. No more Indians come. We don't have enough food.
The dilemma is inescapable. People leave the tribal homelands because the economy is depressed, even with the casinos. In the cities, they intermarry, assimilate. Their blood quantum declines. Their connection to language and family fades. They become Creek by genealogy only. So a slow motion collision seems inevitable between urban Creeks and thin bloods interested in services and economic advantage and traditional Creeks, most of whom still live in rural Oklahoma and are desperately trying to hold on to traditional culture and community. The struggles of the Creek Nation are not lost on Paula Starr.
I just chuckle when somebody calls and asks, you know, I just found out I'm Indian on my mom's side. What are my benefits, or where do I get my land, or how much money do I get in a check? Where do I sign up to be Indian? Well, which tribe do you want? Well, I don't know. So, you know, those kind of things, happen, but that's okay. They're searching.
One of the most popular pamphlets distributed by the Southern California Indian Centers helps people trace their native family roots and register with the government. Chasing blood quantum is a complicated problem, even for Paula's own family. She is Irish on her mother's side, and 40 years in Los Angeles have thinned the family's Cheyenne blood even more.
But in the old days, before contact, pre-contact, you know, people intermarried all the time, and no one said, oh, your children are this, this, and this. No, they're Cheyenne, they're Lakota, they're, you know, whatever the tribe may be. You just got absorbed into that. So now our children and great and grandchildren are getting cut, I guess, sliced up. I mean, I know full-blooded Indian people or children, younger people, who are one-eighth, but they're full-blooded. But yet they can't be enrolled with the one particular tribe. And I just think that's such a hardship, because I have a daughter who's not full Cheyenne, but three, four different tribes. Now my grandson is even more. He's Cheyenne, Chippewa, Lakota, and Mexican. Yet, when you look at blood quantum, he's more Indian than the rest, you know, myself.
More Indian, yes, but not more Cheyenne. It's a trap created by a century of policy designed to wipe out the tribes. Before the European genocide, a child adopted into a tribe would learn the language, the customs, the ceremonies of that tribe. No one could survive by just being an Indian without tribal identity.
We want people to get careers. Yeah, we want people to get
the first line of defense against assimilation in the city has always been the Southern California Indian Centers, created in the 1950s by relocation pioneers to help the poorest of the poor make the transition to city life.
Most of our clients that, like we mentioned, come from out-of-state reservations, and they're hourly wage is not as good as it is here in California. Some of them make minimum wage or even less than minimum wage.
I come from out of state, they got families, they got a baby, and they come right to your office in the street. That's as far as they can get. They got no food, they got no more money, they got no gas, they got no diapers. And those are the kind of cases that we've got in the past. And what do you do?
What do you do? Since the boom time of the 1970s and 80s, Paula's budget at the Indian Centers has been shrinking each year.
Our annual powwow, which is our major fundraiser, isn't enough to sustain us throughout the year. We had to close down our medical program. We couldn't fund it ourselves. Yet there's a tremendous need. We need like four or five Indian clinics throughout LA County to service our community. Our legal project, we're running low on those funds. And I'll be real upfront with you. We developed a community development corporation specifically to do housing for our community members, because we're geographically dispersed in different pockets all over 5,000 square miles. And it's been so hard for people to hear what our needs are. Anaheim, the city of Anaheim, bluntly told us, we don't want your kind here. We don't want the drunks. We don't want the drug users. That was really hard to take.
To keep second and third generation urban Indians connected to their tribal roots, the Indian centers offer drum and dance classes, language instruction, and parent support groups. This bare bones approach to survival has created a tightly knit group of parent activists, women like Annette Phoenix. Annette is Tohono O'odham from a small reservation in southern Arizona. Her mother came to Sherman Indian School in the 1950s and stayed. Annette grew up a city girl. She's the single mother of four boys.
How hard is it raising four boys, single mom?
It's pretty tough, especially when me and our dad separated. Yeah, it was really tough because no extra income was coming in, and I was just barely above that poverty level where, you know, I couldn't get services. The kids, you know, like, they don't go to a lot of events that the school offers or anything like that. They'd rather be involved with stuff that the Indian Center has, or just being around other Indian kids.
What's it like to watch your boys drumming and singing in a powwow?
It's a good feeling, you know, that they know what they're doing or how to carry themselves.
Now, why is it that two of them have short hair and two have long hair?
I don't know. With Adrian, he kind of like, he had struggles going to school with his long hair, but, you know, it just like passed, or he told them something back, or he probably got into a few fights. Just like Nico, he just like tells them something back and just keeps on going.
Annette balances the chaos of city life better than anyone I have met so far. She respects the economic and educational opportunities of the city, but she is insistent that the boys stay connected to their tribal roots in Arizona.
We go maybe like three times a year. We'd like to go more, but it's kind of costly, and then taking the time to go, that's the difference. But we go there, go visit family, and we're involved in a traditional singers and dancers group. It's good because I really want the kids to, you know, I'm raising them, so it's more like they're gonna learn my ways.
Nico, get out of there! Turn back around.
Change the car. I'm gonna change a gun.
Shoot him. Hopefully, they would marry somebody from my tribe.
Oh, I'm running.
I mean, as long as mainly, I guess, as long as the person is Native American, Indian, then that blood will be stronger. Yeah, because I don't want them losing their blood down the line.
So Nico, is it?
Yeah.
I can't get your name right. So you started learning potatoes at 7, right?
Mm-hmm.
How about you?
In August.
Since coming to LA, one thing I've wanted to do is spend Thanksgiving with an Indian family. Today, Annette has invited me to her home in Pasadena.
Yes.
This is about the only thing I'm pretty good at, peeling potatoes, besides making macaroni and cheese.
And on this Thanksgiving day, the Dallas Cowboys are hosting the Washington Redskins.
Who's rooting for the Redskins?
Nobody.
Are you Redskins?
Yeah, I guess.
Does it bother you the name of the team is the Redskins?
No.
You don't think it's like...
How's it gonna bother somebody?
What does that mean?
Well, it's not a very nice term, is it? Redskins?
Huh? We're supposed to be Indians?
Yeah.
It's clear that the boys would much rather play football than watch it.
I'm gonna grab these cones.
All right,
guys. What's the traffic?
They pull me outside and divide up teams.
Okay. So you're... It's you and Fabian.
Yeah.
And you two. Okay, I'll be official quarterback. That's how it works. I'll count aloud five apples, and I have to throw the ball within five apples. Okay?
Just tag you more.
No, no, no. You guys just cover it. We'll have two guys. 5 seconds. Let's do the kickoff. How do you do? You just throw it, right?
Yeah.
All right. Two apples, three apples, four apples. Touchdown! The Redskins are leading the Cowboys. No, it's 7-all. 7-all.
Savannah has arrived.
Annette's extended family arrives from their reservation in Arizona. Two of them came on a Greyhound bus. It was a $40 cab ride from downtown LA to Pasadena.
Here it is. Cowboys and the Redskins. Intercepted.
Oh, well. Skins lose it, but happy Thanksgiving.
Yeah, well, nothing new about that, eh?
Yeah. There's always
Bye,
next
guys.
Year.
Come on over.
Always when we do a prayer, like when our people gather to eat, we always make a plate for the spirits that left us. And this is like for our ancestors and our that have gone before. And we always put a little something for them because they're here with us in spirit as we join together.
In Southern Tat, my puppy dad are up here. To some way, kitten. To she checked the app and let me be a joke. Wait to Massa I a hoi kit, come on, check the hugger motum. Let me be a joke at the wheelchair. Hugger mom, a chug ya, mumuk. Hugger mom, be high to come. I'm gonna bless this food. What's it? We'll see that. Either had you much of a wah, either the shot, either much sweet grass about Arka. It was a non kite mass or at the Mukaja, either not come for say toy got that. Amen.
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 Thank you.
Okay, go ahead if you could start. Okay. Help yourself.
Veronica.
I know. Mm-hmm.
Do you remember the other day we were driving and I told you what this was?
The rope?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you remember?
No.
A teen. How about those right there?
What?
The trees on the side?
Not really.
Do you remember?
No.
Sin.
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 Sin. Sin.
How about the houses over here?
Casa. No, that's just Spanish.
Hole one. And then sometimes when we're in the house or out driving around, I try to name off some trees, road, cars. And I think if I do that every day, I'm sure they'll pick up the words, but the language is really important to me for them to learn. You know, I wish I would have started when they were more younger.
Annette's friend from the parent group at the Indian Center is Priscilla Rodriguez. Priscilla is Navajo, married to a Mexican, raised by her grandparents in a hogan, sleeping on sheep skins on a dirt floor, cooking outside. As a teenager, she enrolled in a foster program through the Mormon Church, and like so many pioneers before her, rode the train to Los Angeles.
Your foster family picked you up at the church.
One of the church buildings, yeah.
And what did they do when they first saw you?
Hug me. I got the hugs I never got before. I mean, my grandmother was there, you know, but she taught me, and I know that, you know, she taught me from her heart, but touching and hugging wasn't something that I was used to.
Yeah, but I sometimes think we know more Spanish than we do in Navajo, because mostly we go to Mexico and our dad like teaches us Spanish, and We're mostly stuck on the Spanish language, so my mom's gonna try to help us learn Navajo too.
Clash then.
Clash.
Truck.
Clash.
How do you say ocean?
Tuo.
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 Tuo. Kind of like tuo, meaning the ocean. Uh-huh.
Tuo.
Johanna, eh?
Johanna, eh?
What is truck. The sun?
Oh, whoops.
The sun that you can't see. Johanna, eh?
Johanna.
Here's the problem. Navajo is a desert language, a language of red rock canyons, pinyon pines, willows on the edges of small streams. It's a language of flash floods and scorching summer heat. It's a language of place, and the sadness of losing it is that we lose real knowledge about the desert southwest that is thousands of years old. But it goes deeper than that. These lessons are all that Priscilla has to link her daughters to Navajo culture. I'm left with the sad feeling that these girls may never be more Navajo than they are at this moment. It bothers me that I don't speak the Ojibwe language. And for the first time in my life, I want to sit in some elder's kitchen in Bad River and just listen.
But on the 20th, she was use of alcohol. And then on the 24th, she missed her fifth check-in.
These are freshman teachers at Sherman High School, and this is their weekly meeting to troubleshoot problems with their students before they get out of control.
To me, she's depressed.
Do you want to write the referral, or?
Yeah, I could write a referral for that.
You're right, she's withdrawn. She's always had her head down. But she's smart, you know, she can do the work. I believe she passed my class, but I'm not excusing her. I think part of it would be cultural, I think. I was like that.
People often ask, what's wrong with you Indians? Why can't you assimilate like the rest of us? I never know quite how to answer that question, but I think it has something to do with an Indian spirit that simply refuses to die. No matter how white I pretended to be, I was still Indian. I feel my Ojibwe spirit most strongly when I'm around birch trees and Great Lakes, places where my mother grew up. But what if you're surrounded by concrete, freeways, and steel, 1,000 miles from your tribal homeland? For all the great things Sherman is trying to do, the bitter fact is Sherman students are cut off from their families and their tribes. At least a third will drop out or be sent home before the school year is over.
At Sherman, I did my dissertation there, and you know, there was about 78% had some type of, you know, alcohol or drug problem, followed by depression. It's higher than any other ethnic group.
Dr. Carrie Johnson is Wahpeton, Dakota. On her first day at Sherman as a mental health counselor, she found over 20 students under suicide watch. These days, she works with Native American children in the Los Angeles County Foster Care Program.
A lot of our children that we see, for example, have been through, you know, not only one trauma, but often multiple traumas in their life in terms of physical abuse, sexual abuse, and neglect. But then when we look at multi-generational trauma, we look at what has happened to their parents or what has happened to their grandparents or their great-grandparents and how that has been passed on from generation to generation.
In my opinion, all of our people are at risk for something, whether it be substance abuse, suicide, poverty, they're all at risk. And here in California, we have a 60% dropout rate of our high school students. Our Indian youth are dropping out twice as much as the Indian youth across the country. That's at 30.4%. We have the highest suicide rate. We have a 56% non-graduate rate. We have 40% plus poverty rate of just our Indian youth in LA County alone. That means almost half of our families are in poverty.
The only way that we can resolve the multi-generational traumas is really going back, is really getting in touch with our culture, our spirituality, a lot of things that were lost.
Oh,
put that tobacco in these holes, it's not just your prayers that are going to go in there. It's going to be your ancestors going to be there. You know, you have children, man. It's something that you're going to hand down to your children so that they don't come to this place. You know, California a lot.
In a rocky, abandoned corner of the state youth prison at Chino, Jimmy Castile and his friends are trying to do just what the psychologists recommend, use Native spirituality and culture to give new hope to a lost generation.
Our churches and traditional Native American sweat lodge. It's built in the California style, turtle lodge. And I'm California Indian. We have this concept that when they walk through those gates to the Red Tail Lodge, that they are walking out of the institution and onto sacred grounds.
How you been?
All right, how you been?
Good, brother. Good, man.
It's been a while, right.
Turn around, bro. All
right. Many of these young men are California Indians, but most grew up in a fog of lost identity, often as Mexicans, with no real contact with traditional tribal culture. There are no illusions at the sweat lodge. These are dope dealers and rapists, robbers, and even murderers. Some have been in the system 8, 9, 10 years.
So I've done time before, you know, so I know exactly what you guys are going through, man. So, you know, like the wool over the eyes don't happen around here, you know what I mean? I'm real.
My elders, as well as the institution, have told me, you know, don't get too close to these young men. And it's really difficult, you know. I believe that by giving their culture back to them, their spirituality back to them, will contribute to their healing.
I used to like to hurt people, you know, and fight and all that, but that ain't me no more. I want to be peaceful. I want to be known as a peaceful person. Now I'm just like, people look at me like, man, you changed a lot. And that's just, I like that kind of feeling. It's better for me.
Roberta Luna has been in the system for 9 years. This is a special ceremony for him. He'll be paroled in a week.
Just program your mind. You know, keep going to the sweats and keep going to all the religious ceremonies. You'll be all right.
I went to church. I went to Catholic church. I went to Protestant church. And, you know, all that wasn't for me. I didn't feel that. I didn't feel that kind of a vibe that was meant for me. And this Native way was meant for me. I feel it. When I'm in that sweat lodge, I can feel the goosebumps. It gives me like more energy. It's like, man, I get more excited.
What you want to do is you want to get it to where it bends like this, in. Okay, it's going to have a bend in, natural. Don't pull, all right?
Just put your hand on it.
You see where the knots are and everything? That's where it snaps. Here, put your other hand here. There you go. All right.
Pull it down.
You got a danger spot right where my left hand is, okay?
You got one right by your right shoulder, too.
Yeah.
Keep there.
Hang on.
We'll bring it in.
Yeah, don't be scared.
He's shaking you like that, brother. He's sticking me in the problem.
You guys be gentle.
Oh, it's already ripped up.
This one?
Grab the box, right?
Oh, patience.
This thing, the whole trauma, this.
Oh.
Oh, good.
I believe each one of them are unique in themselves, and they each have something to contribute to society. We need them back in the community. I mean, we truly need them. And we want them to heal from their problems.
I want to say thank you to all of you. Don't forget to thank your relatives on the way out.
Oh, all my relatives. Oh, to all my relations.
Come on, bro.
Okay, your spirits come to you, don't they? Love you, nephew. Take some deep breaths in your nose, real slow. Hi, this is Jimmy. I got one guy that needs to start with his checkup.
And that way you can be here by 6 and then they'll let me go right after 6.
So that's it, huh?
Ooh, yeah.
So you gonna get it right this time?
Yeah, man, I got to. I still have my driver's license out there, everything's still out there. So
the car's the thing that's gonna get you in trouble. Hey. The car and a woman is gonna pull you down.
Nah, man.
When you walk out those gates tonight, I want you to take a moment to feel what it feels like as soon as you walk out. And I don't want you ever to forget that feeling. That feeling of freedom, of liberation. When you walk out, don't even turn around and look back. Just keep going forward. Okay.
All right, there it is. That's exactly where we want it.
Excuse me, Indians can't golf?
Cool.
That was good.
Okay, and I tee up there going that way. Oh. Was it par 3?
It's January, and I've been invited to play in an Indian golf tournament at the new Verona Tribal Resort.
Down there.
My host is Tracy Stanhoff. She's Prairie Band Potawatomi and Choctaw, and she's president of the American Indian Chamber of Commerce.
Tracy, the American Indian Chamber?
Pleasure. Welcome to Verona.
Thanks. It's beautiful out here.
The Verona Tribal Resort was built with the profits made from Indian gaming.
Oh, yeah.
Just get up. Oh, yeah. We're going to make par. We better.
That was a beautiful shot.
Thank you.
Alright, that's a birdie.
I'm hoping that Tracy will lead me to Mark McCarl, chairman of one of Southern California's richest casino tribes, the Pechanga.
Nice.
And then good old Pop.
Organizers of the American Indian Chamber of Commerce are all smiles, but they're facing a serious challenge. Throughout the 1960s and 70s, you could count on one hand the number of Indian-owned businesses in Southern California. But since the federal government started minority ownership incentive programs, everyone and their mother is starting a business and claiming to be Indian.
I don't get offended by people who say they have an Indian ancestry, and what I get offended by is there are some folks in the community that say they are Native and they're not, and they've been proven not, and they're just trying to go after what the perceived advantages are. And that just chaps my hide, boy.
Thank you.
Chairman Macaro, we're presenting you today with our Warrior Award. The rattle is calling the good spirits. The bow is leadership and hunting, and that's what we look for in our American Indian Individual Warrior Award winners, is someone who can hunt them down with a good mind. So thank you. thank you. There you go.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Miyuyan no otnanum, atahum no neshkenam, lovekab atwunat iva upumesh. It's just welcome to all of you, fellow Indian people, people that I know, people that I'm acquainted with, and relations.
Mark Macaro grew up in Colton, California, 30 miles up the freeway from the Pechanga Reservation.
Just a regular teenage kid in Southern California. I think the difference, though, was myself and my siblings, we grew up always knowing that we were Pechanga Indians.
One of the qualities that sets Macaro apart is that, unlike me or almost anyone I know in my generation, he taught himself to speak his native language.
A person needs to look at what language does for understanding one's culture. It's really a key to the soul of the culture. To think thoughts, to express ideas in your native language is something that's going to be very difficult to ever get to again in the way that it existed before. I think out of all the various Luceño bands, my own estimate is that there are probably 7 or 8 Luceño Indians, none of whom are on this reservation, who can actually do that. They can think and express thoughts, and also for whom our native tongue was their first language.
For 100 years, the tribe kept itself barely afloat by selling sand for construction and hay to local ranchers. During the dark years, tribal members dispersed up the road to Colton, south to San Diego, even as far away as Vermont. And then came gambling. Gambling changed everything. Before the casinos, the Pechanga had been a small, struggling tribe. Once the gaming profits started pouring in, long-lost cousins began knocking on the door.
What began to happen then in 1995 is that our enrollment, it spiked to 60. And the following year, it spiked to, I think, 160. And then the year after that, which I believe was 1997, over 430 submitted applications. What is significant there is that in July of 1995, our tribe opened a casino. And so we're wrestling right now with this idea of a third of us hadn't been out there, evidently, or perhaps, but once we opened a casino, they showed up. And I think this frustrates a lot of the existing tribal members. There's this long and tedious and ongoing discussion about how best to deal with that.
These days, Mark Macaro finds himself consumed not just with the issues of who is Pechanga and who is not, but how to shape the relationship between the Pechanga and the vast majority of urban Indians who remain poor and hidden in the shadows of the city.
My tribe and many tribes, in particular in Southern California, have been consumed with politics. The way the political world works is based on money, and money drives the way the system works. And it's nothing that I or we shy away from. Now, as tribes develop economically, they generate this capital. As tribal nations, through in our area, through in particular Indian gaming, capital is generated. The challenge is going to be, how do we get this capital into other segments of the Indian community?
It's an enormous challenge. Perhaps the real question is this: do successful tribes like the Pechanga really have a responsibility to reach out to the larger Indian community?
The way the compact is designed and signed for the casino tribes here in California, they must take care of their own. their local community, their reservation, their tribal people. They've been all doing a very, very good job of redoing their housing, education, medical, the roads, you know, you name it. They're doing really well in those services. And then they need to take care of their surrounding local community. And here in Los Angeles and Orange counties, we don't have a federally recognized tribe. We have two state recognized tribes with no land base. Mm-hmm. And as a result, there's no money.
My tribe operates a modestly profitable casino on the southern shores of Lake Superior, but it hasn't made us rich. I confess that I do get envious of rich Indians. If I could get away with it, I would claim to be a Pechanga. But I don't think my mother would appreciate me switching tribes. If she were standing in that steam-filled kitchen back in Milwaukee right now, she would roll her eyes and tell me to stop being an uppity Indian. Don't ever forget, she used to say, you're just one generation away from the bush. Every tribal nation has its memories of the genocide. Sand Creek for the Cheyenne, Wounded Knee for the Lakota, the Marias River for the Blackfeet. But in California, the genocide started 100 years before Wounded Knee, before the names of the tribes were even known to the American public. And it was a brutal, massive genocide with a vicious twist. It was done in the name of the church, and in the name of salvation.
That first footstep of Father Serra and Portola and the whole group to come into the LA Basin in 1771 is the beginning of the end. When all of the villages were being destroyed and the Gabriel and the Tongva were all part of the workforce, the great slave system that was going on in Southern California, many people not only fled and intermarried outside of the LA Basin in order just to survive, many of them began to say, I'm not Indian, you know, I'm Mexican, I'm anything else.
There was a time when the entire Los Angeles Basin, from Santa Monica to the San Gabriel Mission, was the home of the Tongva. And then, in a brief nightmare of 60 years, it was all destroyed.
They kept all that Indian tradition quiet and kind of hidden. Afraid of the church. My grandfather never went to church, never. Didn't trust them at all. It was just that feeling that had carried over from the late 1800s into the early 1900s, that at any time someone might come in and take things from you, either the land, your house, your children. And it was still there, so it was kind of a spooky part in the background.
Only the ghosts were left. Mission cemeteries and ancient burial grounds occasionally unearthed by the bulldozers of progress.
But when I began to find out more from my father and from some of the elders in tribal council of those roots, that just hit 100% wham! And it was like, whoa! Here's a whole side of me that is so exciting and wonderful. And he pulled out the abalone shell. And I just looked at it, and it was filled with sage. And he lit it and blessed me. And I just fell apart, you know what?
These days, Mark Acuna is a member of the Tongva Tribal Council, a tireless advocate for federal recognition, and finally, at peace with himself.
Despite everything, despite the attempt of the church, despite the attempt of Spain, despite the attempt of Mexico, despite the gold rush, despite everything being taken, they survived. And they're here. And if you can't be proud of the fact that your ancestors survived to get to you, I don't know what's going on.
There is a belief among some tribes that the lives and stories and words of each generation hang in the air, exactly where they happen, forever. It's the main reason that tribes consider certain places sacred. Each corner of the world has its story and its ghosts to be honored. It's April, and a small group of Tongva and Haxhimin Indians, led by the Robles sisters, are talking with the ghosts of San Juan Capistrano, one of the most outspoken of whom is their mother, affectionately remembered among Native activists as Grandma Lillian Robles.
The last, I would say, 10 to 12 years of her life, she devoted to preserving sacred sites. She was called. She'd be sleeping at night, and the ancestors came and talked to her. She'd hear clicking in her ears, you know, like she was called. She didn't have a choice, you know. Well, maybe she had a choice. She could have ignored it. But she was told, this is what you are to do, in the, you know, this is your job. And she took it seriously.
There is something uniquely Californian about this demonstration. Pressed between a busy road and the chain link fence of a school construction site. What are they doing here? Across the fence is the ancient village of Putium and its graveyard.
This is sacred land. We need to try to get them to understand what sacred land means. You know, that it's like Arlington Cemetery. We're setting out to say, you know, these are sacred sites. These are burial grounds. These are things that can never be replaced. These are our ancestors. They deserve respect, you know. You can't put a money value on them. You know, you can't, you know, like, it's not appropriate to build a $500,000 house on a burial ground.
All over Southern California, the descendants of Tongva and other ancient tribes have decided to make their stand and build a modern identity by defending sacred places against the bulldozer.
Songs are one way to bring back healing, you know, to the land, to sing the songs of the land, to sing the actual songs that are part of California traditions.
And that was something that we were directed by our mother to do while she was still here, you know, like she strongly encouraged us to sing the songs on the land. This society, you know, that we live in, a society that really doesn't value the past, that really isn't, you know, is going so fast that, you know, they're not seeing, you know, like what's 50 years or 100 years or 500 years ahead, that we as a group have to say, you know, no more, you know, this has to stop.
They won't win, at least they won't stop the bulldozers. This is Los Angeles, after all. The push of modernization is ruthless and indifferent to the ancient voices that hang in the air. The developers have lawyers and money to spread around. The Robles sisters have only their faith, and they refuse to give up.
We're outraged. You know, we're totally outraged. I mean, how could you not? A developer wants to build on a site that you know is a cemetery. You know, but we don't take the antagonism approach. You know, we take the approach of we're righteously indignant, you know, but somehow we have to get them to see it first.
Of all the chords of Indian life that I have followed over the last year, the campaign to save ancient burial grounds resonates most deeply. My mother is buried alone in a small cemetery in northern Minnesota. I recently told my brother something that's been in my heart for a long time, that maybe it's time for us to bring her home to Bad River. I have been in Los Angeles for almost a year, and the final lesson of my journey is the most simple. Perhaps it's time for me to go home too.
Hi, how you doing? I haven't seen you in a long time.
Hi, guys.
What are you doing?
I'm getting him ready for the powwow.
This is your husband, right?
Yes.
Hi, husband.
Oh, hi.
This is Ben Yahola.
Nice to meet you. Mark
Anthony. I'm Donna Yahola. Indian school. Yeah.
I'm not different.
Learn more about contemporary American Indians and their history at pbs.org. A DVD of Indian Country Diaries is available by calling the number or writing to the address on your screen. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Ford Foundation, and by contributions to your public television station by viewers like you. Thank you.